So yes, so thanks for having me. In the next 7.5 hours that we have together, we'll cover quite a bit of things. Originally, I was going to call this, which is, I think, a really, 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 really boring title. Hi, guys, back there. I see you. It's our Oak Ridge Center friends. But I have been to your websites. I have been to your Facebook pages. I have been to your Instagram accounts. And so as a result, I have decided to change the title of this presentation. It is now called, Here is Precisely How You Are Screwing Everything Up. With love. There are 5 mistakes that we see shopping centers do every single day in social and digital. And I'm going to share with you what those 5 are and some ways that you can fix it, obviously. You heard a bit in the introduction, some of the brands that we work with. We work with lots of shopping centers. We started our business with shopping centers, in fact. And obviously, we'd love to chat with you as well. So let's start with the first one that you're all doing wrong, which is you are crippling your own reach. Reach, of course, is the number of people that you're going to be able to see, or the number of people who are going to be able to see you. And this is more specific, although reach exists in LinkedIn and Instagram and Facebook and Twitter and so on. Really, reach is most important on Facebook for a couple of reasons that we'll cover in a moment. But the things that your marketing team are doing or your social team are doing are more than likely crippling your reach because they do not understand the connection between engagement and reach. This is very different than Twitter, where at least today, although this may change any moment now, but at least today, Twitter is one big chronological feed, right? Everyone you follow, it shows up. Facebook is not like that. Not everybody who likes your mall's page will see your content. That's not how it started. When it started, it was a nice big pie chart. It was easy to talk about because 100% of people who liked your mall's page would see your content on Facebook. And then Mark Zuckerberg decided to make some money. So he started restricting that. And it went down to about 21%. For the longest time, the average was about 21%, which sucks. You know, you spent a lot of money doing these like ads and you got people coming, oh, like our mall's Facebook page, and then only 1 out of 5 people are seeing it. As of the most recent numbers that we have, which was LocoWise December, so about 1.5 months old or so, it's down to 10%. This, by the way, when this number came out, people in my business got really happy because it had been 2% for a long, long time. 10% is actually a 9-month high that we're sitting at right now. So what this really means in real numbers is that for every 1,000 people who like your mall's Facebook page, there's only 100 of them who will see your content, and that's on a good day, right? Usually it's about 20, and this is assuming you're doing the right things. But most mall's pages that we see are not doing the right things. They are focusing their efforts more content's important, but much less on engagement. Engagement is so critically important in this. Of course, everyone panicked. I mean, when Facebook did this, all the media, everyone in the business got all freaked out. It's like, there's no more. There was never a free ride on Facebook. But let me show you, the other thing that affects this, as you probably know in your own Facebook living, there are different types of posts, right? There are plain old status updates. It's just some text. Come visit Santa this Thursday, right? And then there's photo posts, which are, come visit Santa, we promise he doesn't look this bad, and then a photo of Santa. And then there's a link post, say, you know, which is come visit Santa, and if he does anything weird, here's a link to our security people, or whatever. You make your own things up, right? Each of these different types of posts have different reach. And if you are posting, and by the way, the majority, when we did a bit of a survey through our own engagement tool that we used, this was the order in which malls in British Columbia, it was you people we looked at, this is the order in which the most popularity, the least posted kind of content on Facebook from malls were videos. We'll come back to that. Spoiler, guesses? Yes. I'm such an asshole. Links was the number one thing you posted, right? Which makes sense, right? Here's a link to our mall. Here's a link to a retailer. Here's a link and so on. All right, remember, this scale here is percentage of people who like your page who are actually seeing the content. I shouldn't have done this while you were still digesting food in your stomach. That's whenever you post a link, assuming that this top bar is all of the people, this is how many people are seeing it on average. Photos is a little bit better. Status updates sucks so bad I couldn't even fit the number in the bar. That's how bad it sucks. And videos, which very few of you are doing, actually are the highest. Now this has come down quite a bit. This used to be astronomical. And you'll watch Facebook do this. Whenever they come up with a shiny new thing, this week it's 3D video or 360 degree video. Next week it'll be, you know, chips in our brains or whatever. They always give an artificial push to certain types of content. So they had been pushing video, which is why we had been, you know, doing lots of video and things like that. And so it's still strong. But as you can see, it's kind of balancing out. But notice all the white space above are the people you are not reaching. And the reason you are not reaching them, I will bet my life on this, is because you are not engaging with them. Reach is directly tied to engagement. The more you talk to people, the more they will see your content on the newsfeed. It's how the algorithm works. So stop focusing on how many likes your page has. Who cares? My brand, my company's Facebook page has like 350 likes. And I don't care, but we get 60% reach, which is a heck of a lot better than 30,000 people and 1% reach. I failed grade 7 math, so I think it's better. So the secret is actually this, right? It's to have your fans engage with them. Just because you have a Facebook page doesn't mean anybody's seeing it. So especially, and I'm going to focus on Facebook for a couple of reasons, which we'll come back to. One is that it's the only cost-effective social tool right now. But as a result of this, the only thing that matters is getting on that newsfeed. That is the only thing that matters. If you do not have a high enough, what Facebook calls edge rank, which is the digital relationship between your guest or your prospective guest or a tourist in town and your brand page, they simply will not see your Facebook page. And sometimes I have mall managers who will, well, not mall managers, but sometimes I'll have clients or friends or people like that that'll say, well, they can just go to our Facebook page whenever they want. Okay, nobody goes to your Facebook page. I'm sorry. I know you made a really pretty cover image for it, and you probably had to get it cleared by legal, and it was a nightmare, and you know you were arguing about should it be this color black or that color black. It's black, it's the same color. No one goes to see your Facebook page. They'll go once just to click the like button, and they don't even have to go there anymore. No one goes back to your page anymore. The other thing that affects your ability to reach people is the waiting. So we're back to engagement, right? The more you talk to people, the more they respond to you, the more they will see your Facebook page in the newsfeed. And when you think about it, it makes perfect sense, right? But imagine Coke's page and Pepsi's page, right? I come along and I click like on both of those pages at the same time. So now I'm going to start to see their content in the newsfeed. Right, I'll see Coke's little stuff, and then I'll see Pepsi's little stuff. But if I only start engaging with Pepsi's stuff, if I like their posts, and you know I see a Coke thing and I just ignore it, and I see a video, so I turn off the mute so I can hear it. Facebook tracks all of that stuff. You turn on volume, they're tracking that, right? Facebook tracks everything you do. It's how they make their money. When I first started at the CBC, I used to work for the CBC, and I'm at the end of the day, I'm a nerd, right? I mean, I'll gladly admit that. And databases, I love, whenever I see, it's so geeky, but whenever I see a database that has empty fields, it makes me anxious. I get anxiety when I see empty fields. And Facebook is just a massive big database of empty fields. What's your birthday? What's your home address? What gender are you romantically attracted to? Where did you grow up? You know, all this kind of thing. And I filled all of them out. And Facebook reports this to all of your friends, right? Todd Maffin has added a hometown. Todd Maffin has added that, you know, he's interested in women. Todd Maffin was born on this date and all this kind of stuff. Reports it to everybody. I didn't realize that when you're on air at the CBC, there's this policy that you can't have personal information about yourself out in a public space. And they've kind of cleaned that up a little bit, but this was you know, back in the 1800s. And so I got a call from this very nice lady at Share Services in Ottawa, and she says, excuse me, but this is Mr. Maffin. She didn't have a French accent. I just find it funnier to do that way. She says, you know, you can't have your information about the computers on the computer thing, you know, it's not allowed, you must take it off. So I started pulling everything off, right? I deleted all of these things. Well, here's what I didn't realize. Not only is Facebook tracking what you put on, Facebook is tracking what you take off and reporting to all of your friends what you're removing. And so one day, Facebook announced to all 400 of my Facebook friends that Todd Maffin is no longer interested in women. And I'm like, no, that's not what I meant. Oh, I need my coffee so badly. Thank you. I swear It's been one of those days. So anyway, besides commenting, right, all of that stuff, besides the type of post, which is really important for reach, all of that, it also depends on the kind of engagement you're having with people. We want them to share the post. That's the highest edge rate. You'll get the strongest connection with them if they share your mall's content. You'll get the next highest connection if they comment on it. You'll get a kind of a weak but still okay connection if they like. We really, really want shares. Now, this led to, a little while ago, and in fact, we used to recommend it because it worked, a whole bunch of posts, remember these? Share this to your timeline if you agree, you know, comment. And this still kind of works a little bit, but Facebook's beginning to catch those. And this would work with some malls that we work with and some that we wouldn't work with, you know? We did a post, maybe you saw it flying around the internet. It's a screen of an iPhone, and they've changed it to a bunch of threes in it, and you have to count up how many threes are in it. We posted this to Kildonan Places, which we run, Kildonan Place in Winnipeg. Went on fire. We would never have done this on Oak Ridge Center. Different voice, right? Different brand. So it depends on that kind of thing is really important. So the obvious way that they want you to get onto the newsfeed is to buy your way on. So if you don't have a budget for it, that's okay. Engagement is really good. Asking questions, following up, being really fast is important. But getting onto the Facebook newsfeed is most easily done by giving Mark Zuckerberg some money. So let's talk a bit about how Facebook advertising works, because I think people don't quite understand the pricing model. This is the way pricing used to work on the web. Right, here is how many column inches do you want, how many, and it's paid by that. Facebook is very dynamic. Facebook assigns dollar values to individual people. Every person has a different dollar value. So when you think about these people, it's based on how many other malls, retailers, brands, magazines, how many other advertisers are trying to target that one individual person. So as a result, a guy like this, aged between 40 and 59, lives in the US, he's married, he likes golfing pages. If the only people who were trying to target him was you, that's at City Shopping Center, then he would be reasonable. He would be about 40 cents a click because he has no competition. But he is a 45-year-old American married golfer. So Golfers Magazine wants a piece of him too. So as a result, his price just went up. American dude, I don't know what a dude stick is. Look, it was late. I'm not. Don't hold me accountable. You know, his price goes up. Every other advertiser, his price goes up and up, right? Does that make sense? So it's not about, you know, I want a dollar per click. I'll get you a dollar per click. I'll get you 10 cents a click. But you're targeting this guy. I'm serious. I'm deadly serious. This guy, who's 64, so not a lot of people targeting him, lives in Pakistan, so almost nobody, I don't know why he likes Pepsi, or no, Pepsi's targeting him, probably because he can get, and sometimes, you know, these people drive me crazy. Sometimes you see online these like information product people, they're like social experts, and they're like, I'll tell you how to get 1 cent likes, and you're getting them, but you're getting them from like 85-year-old grannies who, you know, like Chuck Norris. You're getting completely bizarre people. So in other words, the more advertisers that are trying to reach your target, the more that you'll pay. So and how do you combat this? Well, like we were talking about earlier, you know, if you just have good engagement, if you're always on the ball, if you're replying within 5 minutes, you know, if you're quick, if you're monitoring hashtags, if you're engaging with people, you know, if you're doing that stuff, you're gonna be on news feeds more reliably, you're gonna get more brand share, mind share, so you won't have to pay for them. Or you can give Facebook a little bit of money. Now, the managing of this is, you know, we do this for almost all of our shopping center clients, where we get an annual promoted post budget from them. And then we spend it for them. We basically say, okay, this post is picking up some steam, or, you know, this content is good, and we keep track of that and all that kind of things. If you don't have that kind of capacity or ability to hire an outside agency to do it, there are tools you can do. One tool that we really like is called Ad Espresso. And this is the back end of it. And you can say, automatically promote our latest posts, but only if they have the name of our mall in the URL, which is kind of nice, you know? So you know that it's gonna be stuff that's relevant. It's stuff that's, it's blog posts of yours, it's Santa, it's Easter Bunny, it's, you know, all of your promotions. And this works really well. And then it'll actually send you a little email, you know, when it's actually done it. We did this for the Grey Cup. The one that we did for the Grey Cup was, the trigger was, instead of content-based, it was engagement-based. We said as soon as a post organically, i.e. without paying, gets 20 likes, then we know there's something there, so automatically put $20 behind it. And it just handles it. It works really well. Here's another thing that's fairly new that I would encourage you to explore, and that is Facebook's local awareness ads. Now, here's what's really cool about this. Now, in the past, we've been able to do this for a while, right? You've been able to say, I want to advertise to people who live, there's Mayfair in Victoria. I want to advertise to people who live in and around Mayfair, and but all you've been able to kind of get at was really like Victoria, and Victoria plus 10 miles. It was still in miles, even though we're in kilometers, and then Victoria in 25 miles, Victoria in 50 miles. This lets you get really, really, really narrow. But what's really cool about this is it's not based on where people will live, or where they live, but it's based on who we estimate will be in your area based on their activity on Facebook. Oh. Right? So these are, because Facebook has, on smartphones, is connected to GPS. Facebook knows where you are right now. And Facebook knows that I'm really close to Pacific Center right now. Right? And so as a result, Pacific Center could be targeting an area. Now, this is great because it captures tourists, right? You would not be able to capture tourists before. You wouldn't be able to do it because they live in wherever the hell they live. But they're in your block, right? Or wider, obviously, if you're in a larger market area. So there are really, some really good, really interesting tools that are out there that we think are really strong. Sometimes people ask me about Facebook and Twitter, and the answer to that is no. No. Facebook and Twitter, Twitter and LinkedIn, I'm sorry. Twitter and LinkedIn are oppressively expensive. Now, LinkedIn will probably not be relevant, obviously, on the retail side, although it's still okay if you're looking for, executive recruitment, or you're looking for staff, or your retailers are using it for jobs or whatever. But Twitter, too. These things are poor targeting still, with limited conversion. I'll give you a couple of real-world examples. I promoted this tweet last year. This should have been a high-performing tweet because I like to think it's eye-catching. It uses a big click here, it uses a big check mark. It's sort of friendly. It takes up a lot of space in the Twitter line, right? There's lots of blank lines and so on. And so I decided to promote this because part of the way I earn a living is by coming and speaking to conferences. And so I decided that I would promote this to people who follow the accounts of the major speakers bureaus in Canada. Now, on Facebook, this is not a problem. On Facebook, I can say, I want my ad to be, in fact, it's running right now. I want this ad to be shown to people who like this company. EngageQ, my digital marketing agency, competes with a company in town called 6S Marketing. Great company, by the way. They're really cool. But I am advertising against them. And there, if you go on Facebook and you like the 6S Marketing Facebook page, my ads are going to start appearing in there for EngageQ. This would be cool if you could do it on Twitter, right? But you can't. Because if you look really, really closely, it actually says, allows you to reach users with interests similar to followers of these accounts. Does not let you target those people. So if you are helping a retailer open a new store, let's say it's an anchor tenant that's come in, and you decide that one way to reach people who are fans of this is to send a tweet and to promote that tweet to people who already like that brand, you're not going to get them. You're going to get people who like things like that brand sort of kind of maybe and only on Tuesdays. Like it's kind of ridiculous. And it's expensive. That campaign cost me $4.06 per follower before I finally shut it down. LinkedIn is even worse. I had to black out the client name, but this is a LinkedIn campaign that we're running for a client right now who we warned would be expensive. However, they only need 10 leads. They're a B2B large-scale organization. They're looking for very specific people, which they can do. But look at this cost per click. This should be about $1 on Facebook, cheaper if you're doing it right. So LinkedIn, Facebook is really expensive. Worst of all, the worst part of all of this thing is there's no conversion tracking on Twitter or LinkedIn, right? With Facebook, if you have, let's say that you've got a contest that you're running, and the contest is what would be a good example? Let's say that you're giving away stuffed animals. I should never be a mall marketing. I have come up with a terrible, terrible ideas. But let's say that you're giving away stuffed animals. And to get your stuffed animal, you go online and you get a little redemption code, right? So on Facebook, we can track. We can say, here's your code. They filled in, they clicked, which everyone will give you that. But then they filled out the form and they got their redemption note. And in fact, you can even say, and they came into the mall and redeemed it if it's a unique code, right? Facebook will follow that conversion tracking all the way from one end to the other. Twitter goes like this. Yeah, they clicked. I'm so drunk, I don't know where they went after this. Right? LinkedIn, exactly the same. Facebook to the penny. It's really remarkable. And you can do, by the way, there are some ways to ROI this. You know, I mean, if you're, one way is your own average spend per visit. You know, you'll know whether each visit is $60 or $50 or $75 or whatever the number is for you. There are ways that you can ROI it. Internally, what we do, and feel free to use our numbers, is we do an internal value of, let's see if I have this right now, this is why I'm not the numbers guy, $1 per $1 of value for every 1,000 views, $5 of value for every engaged fan, and there's some criteria behind that, and then $1 of value for every link click. Very rough, but at least you start somewhere, right? At least you kind of start somewhere. So that's the first mistake that we see a lot of brands making, is that they're not focused on engagement. And as a result, everything falls apart after that. Your reach will fall down. You must respond quickly. You must respond in the right tone, and we'll talk more about that in a second. The other thing is that we're finding some success, and we're going to be careful because we're going to talk about Oak Ridge in a second. On Oak Ridge's website, we put this in, down here. The Oak Ridge Concierge. I think this is working out great. We haven't talked about it, but I'm on it all the time. And like I should just like open the documents that Oak Ridge send me. You know, instead I just go on to the Concierge. I'm like, what time is Van Gogh close again? Even though Brenda told me what time in like four documents. Let me show you how it works. Really cool, right? This is an actual conversation I had yesterday. They didn't know who I was. It's been edited a little bit. So right in the bottom corner, so you can change it right away at the mall level, you get a little bit of information about this. Now watch. You can tell when the person starts typing. Then they hit me with a little bit of boilerplate, which, you know, it still worked. And then I could rate and I could add a comment. This person was great. And then even this, which is phenomenal. Is there anything else I can help you with today? Excellent customer service. Really, really helpful. They kept typing. There we go, have a great day. Okay, so how is this important? This is really important on mall events. You know, which would be great, especially in the last day or two. You know, do you really want to be surfing through a whole bunch of emails or a whole bunch of Facebook posts that are like, is Santa still going to be here tomorrow? Answer it really quickly, really. And here's why it's even better than email. And most people don't even realize that you can do this, is you can assign different text. And all this is branded, of course, you know, it's their colors, and we use an actual concierge as the photo. You can have different text, different automatic messages appear based on what your guest is doing on your website, based on where they are. And you can have it automated. Don't tell anybody this, but there may not actually be a person behind there after all, but it sure looks like there is. Every summer I do this thing called summer school, where I gather a bunch of people together and I teach them all this stuff in kind of a detail. So as they're scrolling down through the page, this is my wife, it's actually me who answers, but you know, more people, I get, when it's my face, I get nobody. When it's her face, I tell you. So look at this. Now that I'm halfway down this page, Jocelyn types, are there any questions I can answer about Todd's bootcamp day? She didn't type this. I didn't type this. This was automated. But sure doesn't look like, does it? And did you notice it popped up? And yeah, it is a little creepy. Did you notice it popped up and it said Jocelyn is typing? Lies. That was fake. Jocelyn wasn't typing anything. And you don't even get alerted on your computer until they respond to it. And then, bing, 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 it goes off and you can respond. And I would encourage you to try it on these sites when you see them. You know, when it's done well, it works really great. And so you can do it. Different types of content, different web pages on your mall's website, different kind of content. Here's a post about how to do Facebook ads. If you're on this page for more than 30 seconds, Jocelyn pops back. I see you're reading. Now, this might be a little too creepy, the wording of this. I see you're reading Todd's post about Facebook ads. There's more information here if you want someone to help with it. Again, my people are not notified until someone responds. Really helpful. Fairly easy to implement, but definitely worth it. You know, there's so many things. It is when you think back to kind of like when you went through marketing school and in college, right? What is like one of the main things that they teach you there? Overcoming objections. That's one of the primary jobs in marketing, is overcoming objections. You won't know what your objection is if someone's looking at a web page. You know, if there's a thing that says Santa's going to be in the upstairs gallery this year, and here's the information, and that person who's reading it uses a wheelchair, what are they going to do? Are they going to email you? Maybe, and then wait for it. But they can just pop right in. Is this wheelchair accessible? Yes, no problem. We'd love to see you. Right. Answer the objection, and then collect some data on them on the back end, because it'll track everywhere they've gone on the website, what path they took. You can send them to specific web pages. Oh, you're looking for the Van Gogh exhibit information? Well, here, let me send you over to it. Off they go. A record of every conversation that's had before. I love this guy. They just typed in, "Hi, are you a human?" So again, this was me. I don't know, ask me a question only a human can answer. So they said, why is poutine so delicious? So I answered it, and they're like, okay, you must be human. But you know, sometimes it is a little bit creepy, you never know. All sorts of metrics. If you're a data nerd like me, you get access to all this stuff. You get a live dashboard. If you know, you probably won't be that busy. This particular tool that we use, which is called Zopim, has got a great mobile app as well. So you know, if you want to do it after hours as well. So anyway, that is one of the things that I have moved on my little list of things that are nice to do, that things are now a mistake if you don't have it, because it captures so much data and it really can be effective in overcoming objections on the spot, answering really good questions, which convert into foot traffic, which is what we care about. Here's the next mistake. A lot of malls are failing to use retargeting in their ad campaign. Just a show of hands, how many of you are using retargeting? How many of you have heard of retargeting? Got it, okay, got it. So we'll start here. My ads have appeared on the New York Times website. My ads have appeared on the CBC's main website. And I had friends, when I bought ads on the New York Times website, I had friends who were calling me saying, wow, your agency must be doing really well if you're buying ads on the New York Times website. And here's the secret. I didn't buy it from the New York Times. It would have cost me an arm and a leg. What I did was I bought it from a retargeting company. The only people who saw my ads out there on the web are people who had been to my website before. When they land on my website, and we'll talk about your language now, let's say someone lands on your mall's website, you can then follow them around everywhere they go, right? It's like meeting that really irritating guy at the dinner party. You know, who you know you need something from. Like, you know, he runs a tire store and it's wintertime coming up. What do? I sell tires. Oh, yeah, right, I got to get my tires changed. I'll pop by your store, and then you forget about it. And the next day he's at the post office. And you're like, oh, tire guy. God, that reminds me. I got to come in. And he said, yeah, I come in anytime. And then the next day you're at the doctor and he's at the doctor. Oh my God, you're everywhere, right? It's this kind of thing. And why it's cost effective is you're not advertising to your entire market, right? You're not saying, Vancouver! And ages 13 to 65, go. Because 13 to 65 is not a demographic. It's a city. But marketers forget that sometimes, right? So how do you craft it down? One really good audience is people who you know are already interested in your mall because they've been to your mall before, to your mall's website before. So that's how retargeting works. And I get retargeted, you know, this one really pissed me off, I gotta say. So last year I got invited to go to Mexico to give a speech to this food services company. It was like a junket thing. And so I went to the website Barcelo, which is where the resort where it was. And then all winter long, Barcelo started following me around with stupid fucking little ads, you know? And notice what kind of page it's on. Notice the story. It was just a fluke. They were following me around everywhere, but, you know. So it's ridiculous, but it works really, really, really well. Now, here's how it gets implemented on your website. So let's do it this way. So here is Woodgrove Center that we work with. They obviously just went through Pink Shirt, as I'm sure many of you did as well. So the fact that I have now landed on their website means I am now in a little bucket, a little advertising bucket, that I can do wonderful Machiavellian things with as an advertiser, and begin to follow them around. And you, all you have to do is put one little pixel on your website, and it does all this stuff. Now here's how we track it. Let's say that we want to reach out to people who are interested in this next year. All right, we really want to connect with people. How 9 months from now are we going to infer which people in the Nanaimo area might be interested in pink shirt campaigns? Well, you could, again, blitz the market and get who you can get, or you can say, let's target the people who went to our webpage last year about it, right? Which makes perfect sense. So the website address of this particular page is actually longer than this, so I've shortened it, woodgrovecenter.com/pinkshirtpromise. So you go over to your Facebook ad manager, you have your agency do it or whatever, and you, on the back end here, in the bowels of Facebook, you will find this screen. Include traffic that meets the following criteria. So as long as the phrase, and remember, pink shirt was in the URL, right? So as long as pink shirt is in that URL, start putting everyone who lands on that page into a bucket for future ad targeting. I use this on my website for various speeches that I give. I actually have a carousel ad, which is one of those five-fold things that kind of go outside the page and you click the little arrow and it scrolls the next one in, and Facebook automatically optimizes which speech topic is getting the better results. But for every one of these pages they land on, you know, like this viral presentation viewers, for instance, for every time someone lands on that, I've now got them bucketed. So in about a week or so, now that I've collected a couple thousand people who are now spread out onto all of these, I know the people who landed on that page from that ad are probably interested in viral presentations. So now I'm going to start a content campaign targeting just those people. Now, if I'd have gone broad and just said everyone in business, it would have been a, you know, relatively cheap cost campaign because I'm targeting lots and lots of people, but it would not have been very effective because I'm targeting lots. If I had just focused on people who like the pages of speakers bureaus, that would have been good, but maybe quite expensive because those people are also being targeted by Golf Magazine and American Dude Sticks, whatever they are. So this retargeting is really helpful because it means you can follow them around, and then after you've had it up and running for a little while, you have built-in ad audiences. Right? And you don't even have to be that creative. You can say on that previous screen, you can say, anytime the URL has Santa or Christmas or holiday, any of these phrases, put them in a bucket called holiday or Christmas or whatever you want to call it, right? And then when your next promotion, when you've got that contest coming up, you want extended hours, you want to advertise, you know that there are a couple thousand people who not only have been to your website, but have already been interested in that kind of content. Facebook makes this incredibly easy to do, and yet so few people do it. It's bizarre to me. All right, this might be the biggest mistake that people make: engaging like a robot. I really should have cleared this stuff with you before I. I think this one I did last year. So here was one. I've been at Oak Ridge Style, which is Oak Ridge Center's Twitter handle, for 15 minutes and have been bumped into 6 times already without apology. This is a special place. So one of the things that we do for lots of brands is we handle engagement moderation for them. So we're in the channels, we're responding, we're super fast. On Grey Cup game day, where we had thousands of tweets and Facebook posts come in, our response time was under 4 minutes. We have the best team in the country for it. But think about how you would respond to this. Here's what I suspect most of you would do: ignore it. And it's the wrong answer. This needs a response. So how do you respond to this? Tone is really important. Here's how we responded to it. Sadly, you came in on our annual Bump Into Everyone event. Should be back to normal tomorrow. And sorry about this. I'll be honest, this was a risk. This was a risk one for us. We actually got on the phone and talked about this for about 5 or 10 minutes, the right tone. Kildonan Place, Mayfair, Woodgrove, Cross Iron, no problem. No problem with this. Oak Ridge, different audience, different market, you know, older, more refined. So we thought about it and decided to try it out, essentially. We knew that it wasn't disrespectful. That was the most important thing. And response says it all, right? Responding like a robot is something that comes naturally to people who work with head offices. because that's kind of the language of head offices, isn't it? You know, hey, we'd like to thank you very much for your input. You know, I fell down. Santa Claus smacked me in the face with his whiskey bottle and then vomited on my kid.
We'd like to acknowledge receipt of your complaint. We're so sorry that that happened, and we'll make sure to take steps to make sure that Santa is prepared to, you know.
It happens all the time. It happens all the time. I'm not going to call anyone out here, but I've been on mall Facebook pages, and it's sometimes the language is robotic, and it's worse than ignoring it. It's worse than ignoring it. Remember, you are on a social network. That word is really important. It's not a business network. It's not a marketing network. It is a social network. People go there to socialize. So you've got to be in there. You've got to speak their language. Like when this guy tweeted entirely in hashtags, we responded entirely in hashtags. When someone said I need a sick day to get off for the Grey Cup because I really need to go, we wrote her a sick day note. Also, you may notice photos of Marsha on social media sites, apparently at some kind of sporting event. These should be disregarded because Photoshop. We faked weather reports. The weather was really bad for the Grey Cup when it was here in Vancouver, so we mocked up this fake Environment Canada weather request form, which Environment Canada retweeted and told us that we'd made an error in the submission. But it works, right? It works. Because you're speaking like a member of your market, a member of your community, right? That's what malls are. At least malls were, right? Weren't they the center? Don't you still want to be the center? Don't you want to be not just the selling center of your community, but be, you know, like the spiritual center of it? I don't mean like in a church way. But, you know, part of it is participating in the language, in the way, in the tone, in the frivolity of it. Should your brand voice be okay with that? And there are some brand voices that shouldn't be doing that, but... this lady just would not shut up. Now, I have to say, she had a point. What was happening is that they had fireworks, and they were blowing pyro smoke out, but they were blowing them out at everyone in the audience. So everyone was really cool. We had, I think we tracked 800 or 900 tweets and Facebook posts with that, talking about that. So, you know, I went right in, at this point where I went, we went right in. We've been in touch with Easy Place, blah, blah, blah. Well, thank you, and then she's still on it, right? Well, I'm still freaking cold. What can you do? If you remember nothing else from my presentation, remember this. Pug photos fix everything. This is fact. Fixes everything. And then some asshole pointed out that this is not a CFL football in his mouth. It's an NFL football. You can't win. So we arranged to have that guy killed, and he doesn't tweet us anymore. Crises will happen. I thought I had the picture here, but I don't. Crises will happen. One of the major crises that happened during the Grey Cup, just to give you an example of tone, we'll come back to malls in a moment. When am I supposed to stop talking, by the way? I should have checked that, huh? Yeah, okay. One of the things that happened at the Grey Cup is, at least in Vancouver, they fixed this in Winnipeg, and we had no idea, because our client is actually the Grey Cup Festival. Not the actual game. The game itself is run by the CFL. So we just have control over everything except the game, which is awesome because all the complaints come in about the game to the Grey Cup Festival account, which is fine. That's part of the job. So they had the Imagine Dragons performing, and they sold tickets to the Grey Cup game because the Imagine Dragons were performing. They're like, oh my God, Imagine Dragons, I'm going to see them. And the halftime show started. And if you can imagine, this big screen is the stadium. They had the stage like right here. Pointing, and it was only being shown, it looked great on TV, but maybe 5% of the actual in-mall audience. Facebook, Twitter lit up, like we were in a, and we were trying to respond as quickly as we could, and the only thing you can do, and we'll come back to a specific example in a moment, the only thing you can do is things like this. We hear you, we are reading each tweet, and we will pass along to management, because that's what people care about. They care about action being taken. Frankly, they don't care what the action is. They just want to not be ignored. They want to be heard. And then these started flooding in. Because it was, we hear you, all in capital letters. By the way, there's a great thing called the Voice and Tone Guide by this company called Buffer. which I'd highly recommend you go and look. We call them house rules for shopping centers, and we're happy to send you a copy of it if you want. It's basically sort of a for your own staff. You know, here are some ways to behave on social media and here's not. Which brings us to the final point, and that is you're screwing things up when you're mishandling a crisis. Crises can happen everywhere. Nola at Woodgrove Center has been one of our longest running clients, and she has granted us permission to talk about this, and so I took advantage of it and made it basically a chapter in my book. So Woodgrove Center has, like a lot of you have, little kiosks. And at one of these little kiosks, they sell hand lotions, like many of you do. This one guy who was selling hand lotions was really, really aggressive. Like, he would grab women's hands as they were walking by and like start slathering it. No, I'm not kidding. He would actually like grab them and then start putting this stuff on them. So needless to say, it was a problem. I was at this event in Mexico, by the way, when this post was posted to Woodgrove Center's Facebook page. I'm sorry these are a little bit blurry. But basically she's saying, you know, these guys are really aggressive. This one guy is really, we end up going so fast we miss out on the storefronts because we don't want to be bothered. Here's why Facebook is dangerous. This woman is really well connected. She has lots of Facebook friends. She posted this, and it uses words in here that the algorithm at Facebook is picking up on and gives it increased distribution to the newsfeed of her friends. Her friends who do not necessarily even like Woodgrove Center. And this went like wildfire. And I was halfway through my presentation on stage in front of 600 people, and I could hear my phone constantly. And some of them were like people who are complaining, and some of them were our staff members, what the hell is going on, and so on. It picked up, it can go viral for good reasons, it can go viral for bad reasons. Everybody weighed in on this. Here's the other thing to know, is that there are lots of Facebook groups of kind of consumer activists out there. There is a Facebook group in Winnipeg called Winnipeg Moms. Don't ever piss off Winnipeg Moms. These people are organized. Like, you have no idea. No idea. So here's what we did as a bit of a, and I'll show you what happened and how because this could have gotten big. This is the kind of stuff that gets picked up by a shitty little TV outlet that is having a slow news day, am I right? You've all been there, right? They had a slow news day, and what's this? Oh, something's happening in the mall. Let's go cover it. So here's what it was. First of all, one post to everyone, I'm really sorry that is happening. Notice the language here, I, right? It's me, I've signed my name to it. It's not we, it's not corporate anymore. It's with respect to your complaint about the slathering of said lotion objects. It's actual human language. We are reading all your comments tonight and we'll keep reading for the next couple of hours. This is all they want. This is all they want. They would love it if the kiosks were gone, but this is what they want. They want actual action. They want a difference to be made. Even if the only difference that's made is I will put this on the agenda of our marketing team first thing tomorrow. But it kept going. And I even tried tagging all of the enemy combatants that I could. And then you run out of space. And then they kept coming in. And every time they kept coming in, I would get back into the comments. Every 30 minutes, back into the comments, tagging new people. Here's an important point, not copying and pasting the same text. People get pissed off by that, right? So it's essentially the same thing, as you'll read, but worded differently, right? Friendly, probably first thing in the morning, we'll make sure we speak with the kiosk. I'm very grateful you took a second tonight to let us know, and please don't hesitate to message me through this page. That's called moving it offline, which we'll talk about in a moment. And then the next morning, updated everyone. Hi, everyone. You know, here's where we stand on things, right? You begin to build that, it's us. It's all of us together. The mall and the community, it's all of us together. Here's where we all stand. Here's where you and me stand. You guys who hate us right now, we're in the same pool with you. Here's where we all stand on things. I learned this through an unfortunate experience that happened to me when I was starting a podcast. I mean, I had one of the very first podcasts out. I had the 11th podcast in history. It was called the How to Do Stuff podcast. And I would just interview people on how to do interesting things. So I interviewed a friend on who was an esthetician on how to wax people's eyebrows and stuff. I interviewed a jet pilot on how to start a 747. Do you know how this is done, by the way? There's a button that says start. Like, that's it? Like, there's no freaking key to this thing? No, there's just a big button that says start. And because I'm nerdy, I have to show this to you. But for a very brief moment in time, I was the 13th, is that 12th, 11th, 11th most popular podcast in the world. This is Steve Jobs, people! Now, there were only 15 podcasts in the entire world when this happened, so it's not a stretch. So I had this podcast called How to Get Upgraded on Air Canada for Free. And this was my podcast episode. And I'm going to teach you how to do this right now because it doesn't work anymore. And the way it worked is back in the day, they used to have certificates. Remember this? If you do a lot of travel, they used to have certificates, and there were different colors that meant different things and things like that. And so this would only work on flights that were completely full, like completely full. And so it requires two lies. So you're going to think I'm a horrible person. So the first thing is you call about a week before your flight. You know the flight is full. And you say, I'd like to move to business class with a certificate. And they say, do you have a certificate? Here's lie number one. Yes. Okay. So now what they do is they move you out of your seat in economy, right? And the computer puts you into the seat in business class. This frees up a seat in economy. What do they do with the seat? They sell it. Of course, plane is full again, all right? Now, day of the airport, the day of the plane shows up. And they're calling, you know, Star Alliance, First Class, Super Happy, Golden, Lucky Dragon, whatever the top tier level is, you know, and you guys can go first. And you stay there. Even though you've got a business, you just stay in their seat. And now we're going to board from the back of the airplane. And you stay. And now we're going to... And then they go last call. And you still stay in the gate. Like, this requires nerves of steel to pull off, okay? You stay. You don't move. You don't move. And because there's actually two last calls. They won't tell you this, but there's two. There's last call, and then there's last call with your name attached to it. Mr. Maffin, last call. And when you hear that, you still don't move. I know. It's okay. It's all right. It's okay. It's only when they walk toward the door, right? Because when that door is shut, according to Transport Canada, that door does not open again. So then this is what you do. Then you rush up and you're like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. Okay, and then they can have your boarding pass. So you beep, it gives them boarding pass and goes, because it needs a certificate. And they say, can I have your certificate? Here's lie number two. You do this. Yeah. So now remember, the plane is full, okay? It's full, and they just want to board this, and you just start going, I'm so sorry, I know it's in here somewhere, I don't even know what that is, but I'm so, and you just pull like everything out, you know, it's got to be one of these, sorry, hang on just a second, you know, and you spend all of your time. Now think about it from the point of view of the gate agent, okay? Their plane is full. They can either deny you boarding or let you get on the goddamn stupid plane, and it worked every single time, okay? So I did a podcast about that. I know, I'm horrible. Shut up. So I did a podcast about that. No problem. Everyone liked it. All, like, 20 of my listeners liked it. They thought it was great. And I was doing this at the same time that I was on air at CBC, but this was not a CBC. It had nothing to do with the CBC at all. And then, all of a sudden, it went viral. Pre-viral days, before Facebook, you know? It went viral. And it was like a swarm of bees had kind of circled around and attacked me. Well, one of the things that happens with a swarm of bees is bees all come from a hive somewhere. And you can ask the bees where their hive is. Where did you all come from? How did you get alerted to this? As it turns out, some guy had posted this article on a website called Flyer Talk, which is a highly, highly read frequent flyer discussion board. And he basically talks about what the scam was. Except this is not actually what the article said. What the article actually said was, the CBC's Todd Maffin. Oh shit. Cause I was, like, I yeah. And we were getting all of these, you know, the CBC is telling us how to lie and steal. Like, oh my God, okay? You know? Like, I was in trouble enough for being heterosexual with HR, let alone, you know, let alone this stuff. So I had to fix this fast. And how I responded, and I'll show you the response in a moment, but how I responded is actually we've kind of reverse engineered it at EngageQ, and we now use it as a methodology that we license to other organizations called Swarm. And we use it with all of our clients, SWARM. And it is how to respond to a crisis. So the first one is S, and it's all about tone, right? S is speak like a human. Use first-person language, sign it with your first name if you can, you know, be very grateful, very helpful, that kind of thing. This is a really important one as well. You've got to give them a win. I'll show you how I gave these guys, the podcast people, a win in a moment. You've got to give them a win of something. Now, win doesn't mean what would be a good example? Here's a good example, a real-world example. A mall that we work with in the prairies. Had a Santa with the pets day, and the idea was that Santa and the pets day was going to be after hours, so that the pets, you know, there wouldn't be any allergies or attacks or whatever, and some security guard just misread the instructions or something and stopped people from coming in even though it was still time, and people had come long distances to get a picture with their iguana or whatever the hell it was. But that was a problem, right? It was a problem. So what was the win? We couldn't comp them a $100 gift certificate at every store. The win was, we've heard you. We're going to take this up with the right people. And then we ended up opening an extra day as well. Here's another one. Take it offline, right? Right away, avoid a public battle. This is easier to do in Twitter now. You can hit a little button that'll give them a direct link to send a direct message right in there. It works like a charm. It's okay to correct errors, especially on places like Facebook where that information stays there forever. It's just the tone. And then make friends with them, right? Go back to them. Imagine if you were a restaurant and you didn't have, I mean, everyone is so bloody gluten-free in Vancouver now, right? If you had a restaurant and you have a Yelp reviewer and this Yelp reviewer says there's nothing gluten-free and they complain about that, I would put that email of theirs into a little folder and come back to them 6 months after you've got some gluten-free stuff on the menu and invite them back for a $10 gift certificate. Try it out, you know? So let's imagine that this is my wife. She's usually much friendlier than this. I use a wheelchair, and last week I went to your art exhibit. The elevator was packed with people who are perfectly capable of the stairs. This happens all the time at City Square, by the way. Is City Square here? Plus, it was out of order half the time. Hashtag fail. This makes me nervous. When we see this, this makes us nervous because it suggests she's cross-posted it somewhere, most likely to Twitter. You can kind of, when you get to know the language, even certain phraseology, you know, there are certain phrases that are used on Reddit that tweak. When you hear those phrases used in other things, you think this has been cross-posted somewhere to Reddit. So a good meeting monitoring system is important. So how would we respond to that? Really simple. Speak like a human, right? I'm so sorry that happened last week. We like to sometimes say, I'm so sorry, instead of I'm sorry. For some reason, it has more depth to it, more weight to it. It's just a subtle thing, but it works. Here's the win. Really simple. We're going to place signs in the elevator. You don't have to commission a sign company. Just take the 8x, you know, print it out on your laser printer. Feel free to email me directly if you have any other concerns, right? Move it offline. Don't get into a tit for tat, because then it's going to be, you know, we'll put signs in. Well, you said you were last time and you didn't. Yes, we did. No, you didn't. Screw you. I'm not coming back. I'm going to key your car. You know, I mean, it'll get crazy. So move. I don't know where key your car went. I don't know where that came from. There was a factual error in what she said. She said the elevators are always out of order. Not true. Check with the venue. It was never actually out of order. Though they can admit it can be slower than, you know, it's that kind of say something nice than say, you know, it's one of those things. And then you plan to attend anymore, I'd like to connect later. So I mentioned this new Twitter thing, right? This is the way it used to be. You used to have to, you know, we're sorry that happened. Would you like to care to send us a DM and tell us what happened? You can now actually just click a little link and it'll put this into their tweet for you, or into your tweet for you. So they just have to tap it, send a direct message, so it's moving it offline. Here's how I responded to that. I'm not going to read you the whole thing. But basically, you can see the swarm method in place, right? The tone is really clear. You know, I'm embarrassed that even as a futurist, I didn't foresee how quickly it would spread. Here's the win I gave them. I have pulled the podcast from my site. Well, they loved this, right? But do I care? It's a podcast, I don't care. And I gave them the win, and it shut it down. There were a number of inaccuracies in what they said. And because it was in a public record, I needed to publicly correct it. But you do it politely and so on. And then some humor at the end, right? This looks like a great board. I'm looking forward to participating once this well-deserved lashing is over. All right? Four comments were posted after this. Well, this guy is still complaining about business class, but you know. My favorite was this guy who said, it's okay, don't worry about it. All those guys who are bitching about you trying to scam Air Canada out of an upgrade, those same guys are over on the Hilton board telling people how to scam people out of Hilton gold cards. This, by the way, is what the Imagine Dragons looked like, right? So you can see why people were pissed off. If you had a seat over here and you spent money to go to that. So I want to close with an example of the single worst response retail I have ever seen in social media. So if you think you're not up to par, you're better than this guy. It's a restaurant in New York called Joe's. It's kind of like a hipster burger joint kind of place. They have like super fancy, you know, grilled burgers and things like that. This one lady went on to Yelp, and she had kind of a bad experience. Nothing horrible, but a bad experience, you know? Like, it was tasted like propane. You know, service is bad. And, you know, in my 2 years of living in New York City, I've never had a worse dining experience. Now, to his credit, the owner responded. Unfortunately, here is how he responded. Dear Julia, it has been said an educated consumer is our best customer. Clearly, you do not fall into this category. You are an idiot. Okay? It goes on. I love this line. There's an Applebee's in Times Square. Maybe you should go there with their sugary drink. And then the best one of all, welcome to New York. Now please go back to where you came from. This was so bad, the media started picking up on it, right? It was pretty bad. So, although I have to say, sometimes, you know, you can turn bad things into an opportunity as well. My favorite example is of Yelp reviews comes from this outside of a tea and coffee joint in Boston. This is such a great sign. Come in and try the worst Thai tea that one guy on Yelp ever had in his life. Would you not try it? Right? Wouldn't you try it? I bet you sales quadrupled that day. People are like, I'll try that shit. Let's see how bad this is. You know, it's like when you're a kid and you have siblings. I just farted. Oh, yeah, you did. Right? You know, it's like one of those things. Oh, man, this went bad suddenly very quickly, didn't it? So that's really kind of what I wanted to talk to you about, is a lot of the stuff that I find shopping centers are not keeping track of and not managing properly. You know, one is engagement, we talked about, is so important, so critically important. The types of posts, do an audit or have someone do an audit for you to find out all that stuff. We will be happy to do this for you at no cost, by the way. We're new members, and I'd love to sort of get to know you guys. So we are more than happy. We're only going to offer this today because it's a lot of our time to do, and it's not really an offer we do anywhere else. But since we're new here, I thought we would do it. We'll get on an hour-long call with one of our senior people, with Geneva. Erica, I know you work with Geneva every day at our office. She is one of the best people. So no charge at all. You don't have to work with us in the future if you don't want to. So just email me, todd@engageq.com. I've got cards here as well. And I've also been recording. One of these mics has been recording this presentation. And so later tonight, I'm going to take the audio and I'm going to sync it with the slides. And I'm going to put it up on, well, the website address is gone. I'm going to put it up on our website. So if you had staff back at your office who couldn't make it, or marketing assistants who you thought should see this information, I will have it up there tonight. I need your business card to email you, though, to make sure that I get that out to you. So with that, I will say thank you, and I'm happy to answer any questions if there are any.